So today's class, Charles will talk about the first layer in the TCP/IP protocol model. So chapter 4 talks about the network access layer, and this network access layer is divided into two layers, okay, which are physical layer and data link layer. So today, inshallah, we're going to talk about the physical layer. So the physical layer has three major functionalities. The physical layer has three major functionalities. So the first function of the physical layer is that it defines how the physical network components, okay, by physical network components we mean anything in the network, like laptop, switch, router, bridge, anything, okay, how these physical components are connected using by a cable. What are our means to connect these physical components together? Two things: using cables or media, and network interface card. What is the network interface card? Network interface card is the hardware device circuit inside any device which you can use to interface this device to the network. So when we use the cable to connect our laptops, for example, on Ethernet, we connect it to the network interface card. In the past, this network interface card used to be separate. It used to be a separate card that we connect to the motherboard. However, nowadays they actually integrated these network interface cards inside the motherboard. So nowadays you will not see it as a separate card as it used to be. It's always integrated into the motherboard. So what happens in the case of wireless? This network interface cards will have an antenna. This antenna, it doesn't have to be visible, by the way. This antenna could be just a small circuit inside the network interface card that's used to generate the microwave signal in the case of wireless. So that's the first functionality. The second one is what we call encoding. And by encoding here, we mean that from the data link layer, we receive a frame. And this frame, for as far as the physical layer is concerned, is just a stream of bits. The physical layer, as we said, it deals with bits. It doesn't care these bits represent header, trailer, data, network header, it doesn't matter. Okay? So what we receive is group of arbitrary bits like this. Okay? Type. So in that regard, what is encoding? Encoding is to convert, for example, groups of bits. This group of bits might be like 1 bit, 2 bits, 3 bits. We convert group of bits into what we call codes. Okay? So encoding, to convert group of bits into codes. These codes are represented by different voltage level, or in other words, it's represented by digital signal. So, for example, I can represent the zero as zero voltage and the one as positive voltage. So this becomes zero and then positive and then zero and then positive, positive, and then and so on. So this is the simplest. We call this non-return to zero encoding. So this is non-return to zero encoding. It's the simplest, and it basically converts 1 bit into a voltage level. Zero becomes zero, one becomes positive. Positive, positive voltage could be like 3 volt, 5 volt. Okay? depending on the hardware, how it's designed. This is very simple. Some other schemes, they try to work on the limitations of this, which we will talk about today. And they try to represent the zero as a signal like this, for example. And the one as a signal like, which is the mirror signal. So it's not one voltage level. The zero has two voltage levels and the one has two voltage levels, but they are reversed. Okay? So we'll talk about what is the advantages and disadvantages of each one. So we call this Manchester encoding. Okay? So these are the two schemes that we need to know about. There are tons of other schemes, by the way, which you will study if you are a computer engineering student and you will take Network 2, you will get all the other schemes, yeah, not all, but yeah, you get more schemes and you will be able to analyze and distinguish and compare between the different schemes, what are the pros and cons and so on, okay? So that's when it comes to encoding. Third functionality is what we call signaling. And by signaling here, we mean that we convert the digital signal resulted from encoding or any other signal, okay, into what we call a carrier signal. So we convert digital or analog signal, okay? Digital signal like the one resulting from encoding or any other analog signal. For the case of, for some other systems, they don't use encoding. They use they use another analog signal and then they convert it to what we call into carrier signal. With specific properties that are suitable for the physical media that we're talking about. Okay? So, for example, we need to do signaling to transmit the signal over copper cables. Okay? So, we need to generate the carrier signal to be an electric signal. And this happens for the case of copper cables. Or optical signal for the case of fiber optics. Or microwave signal for the case of wireless. Okay, so this digital signal cannot be transmitted over the different media right away. Okay, so we have to convert it to another analog signal with specific properties that are suitable to be transmitted over this medium. Okay, whether it's copper, fiber optic, or wireless. So within the electric signal type, we have signaling schemes. For the optical, we have signaling schemes. For microwave, we have signaling schemes. So, and again, we have tons of signaling schemes that we will study in the TASER Network 2. Here, we'll cover only two signaling schemes. We have what we call, any analog signal, by the way, has three fundamental characteristics, which you are supposed to have studied that in signals before. Any analog signal has the characteristics of amplitude and frequency and phase. So the three schemes explained in this chapter are amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, phase modulation. However, phase modulation, we'll not talk about it much. Okay? So we will focus on amplitude modulation and phase modulation. So each of these schemes, they focus on one characteristic of the analog signal. Okay? So that's the brief introduction about the major functions of the physical layer. And this is enough to get us through the first two activities here. So in the first activity, we need to perform encoding using the two methods we talked about. Manchester encoding and non-return to zero. And we need to convert this particular stream of bits into digital signal according to that encoding scheme. Okay? Clear? So we need to talk, and more importantly, we need to analyze that. And now we will not just do it for the sake of it. We need to understand which one is better and why. What are the advantages and disadvantages of each one? So we need to have some discussion around this, and we will discuss it together. So for the Manchester encoding, by the way, it doesn't matter whether, yani, you can decide from the beginning if you want to represent the zero like this and the one like this, or the other way around, it doesn't matter. Okay? As long as you are consistent. So this, we have 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. So if we decide to do the 0 like this, let's do it like this. So this is 1 and this is 0, okay? The 1 will be the mirror, okay? And then the 0 will be the mirror of the 1. And then 0. So it will be like this. So you have to be consistent. Okay? Which means that this is connected. And then the 1 will be the mirror of the 0. And then the 0 will be the mirror of the 1. Okay? So that's the Manchester encoding. The non-return to 0 is very easy. So 0 is 0. And then 1 is positive voltage. And then 0, and then 0, and then positive voltage, and then 0. Okay. So which one is better and why? Second one is better? Why? Let's forget about better and it's relative, really. Yani, which one is better? But let's discuss what are the pros and cons of each one. Okay? What is the advantage and disadvantage of each one? Okay? So what is the advantage of Manchester encoding versus the non-return to zero? So in order to really visualize this, we need to talk about some hardware stuff. So remember, physical layer is all implemented in hardware. Okay? So for hardware, we have, for example, a transmitter and a receiver. And by transmitter or receiver here, we mean two network interface cards, whether these network interface cards are in a switch, in a router, in a laptop, we don't care, okay? It's a transmitter, which means it's a transceiver inside the network interface card of that device. So the transmitter will now generate a signal, whether using this encoding scheme or this encoding scheme, and then we'll send it over the physical line. So what's on the physical line is actually, it's actually يعني, a modification of this signal. And now this receiver needs to recover this signal, okay, at this side. So there are two aspects here. There are two aspects. The receiver will have to do two fundamental steps. The first one, the receiver needs to identify the bit boundaries. This is very important. So the receiver needs to say, this is 1 bit duration. This is 1 bit duration. This is 1 bit duration. Okay? We call this synchronous transmission. So the receiver has to synchronize itself in terms of fixed durations of each bit. Okay? The second step is that the receiver will look at the voltage level within each bit and say, from the voltage level, I can estimate that this is 0, I can estimate that this is 1. Okay? In the case of non-return to 0, for example, if I were to recover the bit boundaries correctly, I can just say, within this bit duration, what is the value of the voltage? 0. So the original digital binary bit was 0. What is the value of the voltage? It's positive. So the original binary bit was 1. Okay? Is life easy like this? Of course not. Practically, what will happen? There are some things that happens at the receiver side which tricks the receiver side to actually identify the bit boundaries correctly, and within each bit, identify the voltage levels correctly. So what are these environmental phenomena that will trick the receiver? First, we need to know that any hardware circuit will have to have what technique to for reading or writing anything. Any hardware circuit will have to have a clock. صح? When we talked about computer architecture, any hardware circuit will have to have a clock. The clock is the basic thing inside each hardware circuit that will allow this hardware circuit to transmit or receive anything. So the receiver has a receiver clock, and the transmitter has a transmitter clock. Why did I put them different like this? Because in reality they are different. Okay? So this clock, can I have a clock? A clock is like a periodic digital signal with a specific fixed frequency. Okay? There is a fundamental frequency and you generate a periodic digital signal. And then based on this clock, I can say the bit here or here or here or here. The clock duration is the lowest duration of anything that I can estimate. Okay? So the problem now is that the transmitter and the receiver in general, they cannot, almost never, synchronize these clocks 100%. Because these clocks are generated locally at each device. صح? So they cannot really synchronize these clocks 100%. So there is the phenomena of clock drift that is always be there. Okay? So the receiver, now, if it uses its own clock only, without anything else, let's see what might happen. So assume that for the non-return to zero, we have a stream of bits that looks like this. Okay? What is the representation of this in terms of non-return to zero encoding? It's just a straight line. Okay? Right. The transmitter will send zero voltage, okay? And with 5-bit duration, we'll send it to the receiver according to its own clock. The receiver will say, okay, according to my clock, this is the bit boundary, this is the bit boundary, this is the bit boundary, and that's it. What is the outcome here? The receiver thinks those 5 zeros are a four zeros only. The clock of the receiver tells the receiver that these are the bit boundaries of the signal, because the signal coming, it's a straight zero voltage. Okay? So the receiver will rely on its own clock, which is almost never synchronized with the transmitter clock. So there is always a difference. And this difference, this small difference, might increase with time. Okay? Which will cause the five zeros to become four zeros only, according to the receiver's clock. Why? Because there's no complete synchronization. Okay? This might be exaggerated, but in reality, maybe every 1,000 bits will become 1,001, or the other way around, or will become 999 bits or something like this. Okay? So what are you trying to say? What I'm trying to say is that the local clock is necessary for estimating the bit boundaries, but it's not sufficient. Okay? It's necessary, but not sufficient. Okay? So we need another means. We need other means inside the receiver that will help the receiver to estimate the bit boundaries with high accuracy. Okay? So that the local clock is not enough. Why? Because there is almost never a synchronization 100% between the transmitter and the receiver. Okay? So what is this other means? For the non-return to zero, this straight line does not tell anything to the receiver other than the local clock. So the possibility of error here is high. Whereas for the case of Manchester encoding, there will always be changes in the signal, inside the signal, which is here. Even if we have straight zeros, even if we have straight ones, so?
Yeah.
Okay? There will always be some sharp changes in the signal itself, okay? Which the receiver can use as a complementary method together with the clock to estimate the bit boundaries with high accuracy.
So Manchester,
we call that, in terms of advantage for this for Manchester encoding, in terms of advantages, one, we call it self-synchronization. We call that the Manchester encoding digital signal has self-synchronization. Why? Because it gives the receiver extra information that can help with the local clock of the receiver to recover the bit boundaries correctly. Okay? So the accuracy for estimating the bit boundaries at the receiver side will be higher, much higher. We're not claiming it to be 100%, by the way. There could still be some errors. But here, the accuracy is much higher. Okay? That's the first step. So now, the encoder has recovered the bit boundaries. The second step is that the receiver, or the decoder at the receiver, will look at the voltage level within one bit and then decide whether this signal was originally 0 or 1. Okay? And now comes another environmental phenomenon, which is the effect of noise. Okay? These signals will not arrive to the receiver looking like this. Because on the line, you will always have the effect of noise. In the quiz, I mentioned electromagnetic interference and so on. Okay? So this noise will have the effect that, for example, this non-return to zero signal will in fact look like this. Okay? So these sharp changes are almost always smoothed on the line with the effect of noise and interference. Okay? So if we look at the bit boundary, if we look at the bit duration here and try to estimate whether this is 1 or 0, you have to be very careful, because now the estimator at the receiver side might see the 0 as positive voltage, but it's not very high because the noise has increased that amplitude a little bit. So for example, if you use a zero voltage comparator and say, if it's actually zero, then it's zero. If it's anything above this, it's one. That's very primitive, and in many cases, you will get some errors with that. So you have to be very careful. And you should not expect the amplitude to be completely fixed within the bit duration, because the effect of noise might actually change the amplitude slightly. Okay? So it turns out that the changes in Manchester encoding makes it more resistant to noise. Why? Because you have always some change inside each bit that will allow the receiver to use, not by a voltage comparator, simple voltage comparator, they use some means to detect the change of the signal, whether it's going up or going down. And with the effect of noise, that's usually not affected that much. Why? Because you always have big change between the positive and negative voltage, which will allow it to be more resistive to noise. Okay? You will not have enough noise to bring the positive to zero and the negative to zero. صعب أوي. Very hard. Okay? But for the case of non-return to zero, the noise can change the amplitude in such a way that you can confuse the comparator at the receiver very easily. So we call this noise resistive. So Manchester encoding is more resistive to noise. Okay? It's more resistive to noise. So these are some of the advantages of Manchester encoding over non-return to zero. Type, do I get all these advantages with zero cost? Can you imagine that life is easy like this? You gain everything without paying cost? What is the cost that I have paid? Which is in my case, by this is the disadvantage. What is the disadvantage of Manchester encoding? High cost, yes. This is coming from what, Ba'a? Remember, and I'm trying to have more changes to simplify or to increase the accuracy of detection at the receiver side. But these changes increase the frequency, صح? What is the frequency of a signal? It's the number of changes per unit time. Okay? For the case of Manchester encoding, as you can see, you always have changes, and the changes are much, much more. Okay? So more changes mana higher frequency. What's bad about having higher frequency? Higher frequency means that you have higher bandwidth. This bandwidth, as we all know, for service providers like Ooredoo or something, they buy these bandwidths from the government. They pay for it. They pay millions of dollars. So the more bandwidth you have, the more money you have to pay. And not only that, the more bandwidth you have, the more sophisticated the circuit that you need to have here in order to make this detection with high accuracy. Like the receiver has to be more sophisticated for the case of Manchester encoding, of course. Whereas for non-return to zero, it's very simple. okay, but with high probability of error. Okay, but for the case of Manchester encoding, the receiver is more sophisticated and the bandwidth is more. So the disadvantage is higher bandwidths and more sophistication, more sophisticated circuit. Whereas for non-20-0, it's very simple. Okay? Higher bandwidth means higher cost. Okay? Type. Any question? Higher bandwidth and more sophisticated circuit at the receiver side due to the fact that we have higher frequency, higher bandwidth. The second activity here talks about the difference between amplitude modulation and frequency modulation. For the amplitude modulation, as we said, we change the amplitude of the signal, but we keep the frequency the same. So the answer for this question is easy. For AM, you change the amplitude, fix frequency. For FM, you fix amplitude, you change frequency. Okay? So you have two things. You have the modulating signal. This is the signal that I want to send. As we said, this could be a digital signal coming from the encoding stage, or it could be analog signal. In this case, it's a simple sine wave signal. Okay? And we want to send this over the line, which uses a copper cable, okay, using carrier frequency like this. So I want you to draw how the carrier signal looks like on the copper cable, okay, by combining these two signals such that the carrier signal has changing amplitude but fixed phase. Okay? And for the other one, I want you to do the same such that the carrier signal will have fixed amplitude but variable frequency. So for the case of AM, what we need to do is that we need to create a carrier signal such that the amplitude of the signal is changing, but the frequency means that if you take a window of time, the number of changes in the signal will be fixed. Okay? So the easiest way to do that is to take this signal, shift it a little bit up, and then try to put it, and then put it in dotted, because this is not the carrier signal. This is just how the amplitude of this signal will change. And it will be like this. Okay? That's not the carrier signal. That's how this signal looks like. Okay? And then we'll take this signal, and then with fixed frequency, we'll try to draw it like this. Okay? So if I take any window here, the number of changes in the signal will almost be fixed. However, we call this envelope of the carrier signal. So the envelope of the carrier signal is proportional to the actual modulating signal. Okay. واضح كده؟ So that's how the AM carrier signal looks like. For the case of FM, the amplitude itself is the same. So we fix the amplitude. What will change is actually the frequency, and the frequency changes according to the amplitude of this modulating signal. Which means that the amplitude here is low, okay, it's close to zero. So here, the frequency will be slightly low. As we increase the amplitude, we increase the frequency. And then we go down all the way to negative. Negative means that the frequency will be reduced even more. Okay? So it will look something like, so first we start from relatively low frequency, okay, which corresponds to these amplitudes. And then we will try to increase the frequency gradually. Okay, so now we are almost here. And then we'll go back and reduce the frequency a little bit more, and even a little bit more to account for the decaying negative amplitude. Okay? So if you take a window of time, the number of changes in the signal will be proportional to the amplitude of the modulating signal. واضح كده؟ And then we will go back to increasing the amplitude and increasing the frequency and so on. Okay? But the amplitude itself is the same. The techniques used at the receiver side to estimate these two signals are totally different. We don't have to get to the details of this. Again, we will explain it in details in network 2. If you are computer engineering, chances are you will study this in network 2. If you are computer science, you're lucky. You will not have to get to the details of this. Okay? But that's how it looks like. Any questions? So that's the... So very quickly, with the information that we have now, we can solve the upper part only the upper part. The lower part, we'll talk about it next time. So we just need to do this matching exercise, the top part. All right. So what are the hardware devices, media, and connectors which transmit and carry bit signals? These are physical components. How ones and zeros are represented on the media, okay, which varies depending on the encoding scheme. Signaling, which varies according to the encoding scheme. So it cannot be the encoding scheme. Okay. So it's signaling. Evenly spaced time duration for signals. That's the synchronous. As we said, the synchronous, if we were to achieve 100% synchronization, then we have fixed duration for the transmission. A method for converting streams of bits into groupings of data or grouping of bits predefined. That's a frame encoding. Arbitrary space-time duration for signals, which is the opposite of synchronous, which is asynchronous. Okay?